When I was little, three of my favorite books were Artemis Fowl, The Arctic Incident, and The Eternity Code. The story of Eoin Colfer's PG-rated anti-hero matching wits against a secret sci-fi fantasy society of fairies captured my imagination. And in a world where I saw some of my other favorite books getting adaptations, I crossed my fingers for an Artemis Fowl film. Past Daniel should have been more careful what he wished for. Artemis Fowl released in 2020, coming out directly to Disney Plus after COVID put a kibosh on fun, and I was so eager to see it that I stayed up until 3 a.m. to watch it. Well, okay, eager may not be the right word. What's a word for when you really want to see something to see how badly it's been mangled? Whatever that is, that's how I felt. And yeah, it was awful. It's one of the worst movies released from Walt Disney Pictures, and I think it's an early contender for one of the worst movies of the 2020s. And bear in mind, its competition in both of those categories includes the Disney Mulan remake. Disney's Artemis Fowl has one of the most broken scripts and some of the most baffling directing and editing choices I've ever seen. And here's the thing, Kenneth Branagh is not an incompetent director. He knows how to make a movie not look like shit. Something went very, very wrong behind the scenes, and I'm going to get to my hypothesis there in a little bit. On a separate note, I know a lot has been said about how Artemis Fowl the movie differs radically from the books. But honestly, an adaptation can still be faithful even without being 100% accurate to the books, and in some cases they can even improve upon the story. Book Aragorn is not a very dynamic character. It works for that version of the story, but in a film where he takes up a lot of screen time, giving him an actual character arc is pretty important to make the movie function. The important thing is to be faithful to the spirit of the book, and capture the personality and unique qualities that made it special. Unfortunately, Artemis Fowl doesn't do that either. Okay, here we go. Artemis Fowl opens in the aftermath of the plot, with police taking a strange man into custody near Fowl Manor. This man is interrogated and introduced to us as Mulch Diggums. We're also introduced to the Aculos.
What precisely is the Aculos?
The Aculos. A weapon so powerful and mysterious, it can barely be imagined.
In case you're wondering, yes, Josh Gad does narrate through the whole movie. But no, Josh Gad doesn't do this wonderful voice the whole time. Sometimes he forgets he's doing it and quickly tries to correct it back.
1984! Foreigner is a real classic!
Why did they keep that take? Why didn't they just do another one? Oh my god.
Let me tell you the story of Artemis Fowl.
Oh yeah, Disney is also continuing the trend of meta commentary about stories. Now this is a trope that just personally annoys me, a story about stories, because the vast majority of the time it smacks of pretense. It gets an eye roll from me even in movies I otherwise like. Now there are times it's done in a way I enjoy. This movie is not one of those times.
A story that begins where every great story begins.
And like the stories, you know, they all have an ending that just, well, makes you smile.
And their cities at the center of the earth are not something out of a storybook.
We get it. You're not like other stories. You're postmodern and meta. Get on with it. Anyways, we meet Artemis Fowl, a child prodigy attending a psychology appointment. He's cold and uncooperative, and tries to one-up the psychologist with a smug look on his face.
Crisscross pattern on the head, machine-tooled, makes it 1890s at the earliest. Your grandfather was duped.
So, alright, he's still got a little bit of that edge to him, and he's confronted about how he seems to be chafing under the burden of his father's name. This seems like an earnest attempt to capture the Artemis of the book. Too bad we never see this Artemis again. Yeah, this follows up with him zooming through the forest on his way home, having the time of his life, doing a little kickflip or whatever this is. And then we see his dad, played by Colin Farrell, and they seem to have a perfectly fine relationship. I don't know what this burden of his father's name is supposed to be. The movie never shows us. I mean, Artemis is sad when his dad has to leave on business. At least I think he's sad. But don't worry, his dad will be back soon.
The helicopter is being prepared for me right now, son. I'm sorry. I'll be back as soon as I can.
There's just one very important thing I have to do. And I know it's been hard, but look, my work is coming to an end.
Sure enough, he promptly disappears. Artemis sees it on the news, along with allegations of high-profile thefts that he is suspected of, which makes the boy upset. At about that moment, the phone rings, and Artemis answers it in a panic. At least I think he's supposed to be panicked. On the other end is a strange voice who demands a ransom for his kidnapped father.
I have your father.
What? Who is this? Is this a hoax? If you have my father, I want proof.
Okay, I shouldn't be harping on this kid so much. I think the problem exists outside of him, and I'll circle back to that in just a moment. When Artemis tells Butler about the call, he decides to show him his father's secret. Artemis Sr. is in fact a quote-unquote criminal, but like a vigilante, tracking down magical artifacts and securing them. This puts Artemis at ease, knowing that his father wasn't a bad guy after all. Oh gee, there was almost a compelling dramatic conflict there. Good thing they sidestepped that. Also have to point out that I love that these supposedly powerful, priceless artifacts are all just like bottles of water. So let's sum this up so far. Artemis's father is secretly a collector of powerful magical artifacts to keep them out of the wrong hands, and he's been kidnapped by an evil fairy who demands the Aculos as ransom. The Aculos can, and I quote, teleport armies, wipe out life, open portals between worlds, act as a skeleton key for the universe. So, MacGuffin that can just do whatever the writers want. Awesome. Now, in case you're curious, here's how the story goes in the first book. Artemis's father is just never in the picture. He got blown up by the Russian mafia before the events of the book. But in the process, he lost a big chunk of the family fortune. That's where Artemis himself enters the picture. He wants to restore that fortune by kidnapping a fairy and taking their gold. There is no evil fairy kidnapping his father, but more importantly, there is no Aculos. This thing does not show up in any of the sequels. Artemis does not get this information handed to him via a secret basement of treasures. He very meticulously translates a copy of the book, a kind of fairy bible that they are bound to live by. And Artemis finds this book by deceiving and poisoning a fairy that he finds hidden in a Vietnamese market. The reason I bring this up is because all of what I mentioned was actually filmed. In this deleted scene, you see Artemis even let the fairy he tricked begin to burn alive, until she hands him her copy of the book. Again, this is a version of Artemis that is colder and more ruthless. When this version of Artemis is allowed to exist, I think Ferdia Shaw actually does a pretty decent job bringing him to life. And while at the end of this scene he does mention finding his father, he also mentions,
perhaps a way to get their gold.
I earnestly believe that there at some point existed a version of this movie that was more in line with the original story, but all mention of the fairy's book has been cut from the final product. I think something happened behind the scenes of the production when this movie was delayed from 2019 to 2020. I think some dramatic rewrites took place. I mean, Screen Rant denies this as the reason for the delay, but it's Screen Rant. So take that as you will. I think that's why Ferdia Shaw is struggling so much. Not even the movie seems to know what Artemis is supposed to be like. It looks like Disney got cold feet about having a child anti-hero and just backed out of their own setup. I mean, I don't blame them. It's not like there exists a series of books with exactly this premise that was a great commercial success. The movie then takes us to the underground fairy world, a place of endless imagination with truly mind-blowing designs like, what if regular people had pointy ears? What if the subway station was blue? Yeah, I don't really care for this imagining of the fairy world. I never buy the illusion that this isn't a set. You compare this to other movies, you really feel like this is a truly fantastical setting here. You feel like this is another world here. And this just feels so standard. I mean, this handcuff thing in the ground is kind of a neat idea, but that's not enough to build a unique setting. Also, I just have to point out that the leprechaun costumes remind me of that one Blue Sky Epic movie. I mean, the movie titled Epic, the movie itself is not all that epic, it's actually kind of boring. Hey, just like this movie. This scene introduces Mulch again, on his way to jail, and Holly Short, a fairy police officer who's part of Lower Elements Police Recon, or LEP Recon. We also get a brief scene of our evil villain getting an officer out of jail in exchange for his support.
You will infiltrate Fairy Command on my behalf.
I spy.
You spy or you die. You spy or you die.
Oh, this movie's so screwed. At the station, Judi Dench charges every officer with finding the Aculos, which is missing.
For the peace to remain, so must our secret existence. Preserve that at all costs.
Really keep this assertion in mind. Holly Short is forced to stay behind, both because she's a rookie and because there are doubts about her loyalty. Her father is reported to have stolen the Aculos. At about the same time, though, a troll gets above ground, and Holly is the only one left to confront it.
Stay shielded once you're up there. Total invisibility.
Yes, Commander.
Good job, Holly. The troll attacks a wedding, with Holly arriving just in time. And this scene is filmed and cut in one of the funniest ways possible. So the troll tosses this young girl into the air, and Holly catches her. She then takes the girl aside. The girl was not visibly injured, but Holly stops to help her because she's hurt. But she says this, and the camera immediately cuts to the troll throwing people across the courtyard. Holly just stops fighting the troll to take care of this little girl who could probably just sit and cover for the next few minutes, as the troll is still actively trying to murder people. This is why they didn't want to send you, Holly. The cleanup team arrives to handle the mess, and they cart the troll away.
Total invisibility.
Preserve that at all costs.
However, Holly blatantly disobeys orders because she wants to go to where her father was last seen. Again, this is why they didn't want to send you, Holly. At the same time, Artemis is reading his father's journal, where he learns the villain's name, Opal Cowboy.
A brilliant fairy. Perhaps the greatest of them all, but gone to the bad.
Oh, Jesus Christ. I'd like to take a moment to point out that we're 37 minutes into this 90-minute movie and almost nothing has happened. The Aculos was stolen off-screen. Artemis Sr. was captured off-screen. The one fight we've had is against a troll who's not even a character and is not connected to Opal in any way. We have had a lot of narration, exposition, and characters ignoring that exposition, which is a great way to tell a story. Holly Short arrives at the Hill of Tara, where her father was last seen. She finds his badge lying on the grass.
Total invisibility.
Preserve that at all costs.
Not knowing that Artemis and Butler are nearby. Butler takes down Holly, and they successfully capture her, sparking a full alert at Leprechaun, who scramble into action to find the missing fairy officer.
Not happy!
Yeah, me too, Holly. Me too. Also, I love this clip here that they just stretched in post-production. I did not edit this. This is how it looks in the movie. Leprechaun implements a time freeze on the entire area surrounding Fowl Manor before sending in a strike team, our plot finally kicking into high gear 44 minutes into our 95-minute movie.
Top of the morning.
Okay, I changed my mind. This movie is amazing. Artemis remarks to Butler that he's going to need the suit, before we cut to his suit and tie hanging in his wardrobe with a dramatic musical sting. Okay, so if you've seen my Lion King review, I'm about to repeat myself, but this is a trick Disney's been doing a lot in recent years, trying to market the iconography of a story rather than the actual story. For contrast, in Return of the King, Elrond presents Andúril to Aragorn with this flourish. This sword has a long and dramatic history within the world of Middle-earth, and also has symbolic value, representing the shattered monarchy of Gondor that Aragorn alone can restore. It's an item with incredible narrative gravity. Artemis's suit is literally just his suit. It's just what he wears in the books. And this is framed like, oh my god, it's Artemis's suit! What, are we supposed to cheer for this? He's about to put on the suit! Oh my god, the suit! No! It's not how this works. Just because the movie recognizes something doesn't mean it's a meaningful payoff. The fairies begin to approach the manor, and the dialogue only gets better.
Capture only. We need the humans unharmed. We scare them. We do not kill them. I want them alive.
The fighting begins, and Butler and Artemis quite easily take down the advanced strike team in open combat. Butler grabs a magic bow and arrow and fires a shot at the time freeze, destabilizing it. Leprechaun now has a limited amount of time to complete their mission. The movie then cuts to Opal and Artemis Sr., and the evil fairy explains her motivations and plan.
With the Aculos, I will rise to the surface, then release my army to take over the Earth and own both worlds, and systematically wipe out all of mankind. Then I will restore fairies to their rightful place as humanity crumbles beneath us.
So, Opal intends to use fairy armies to massacre mankind. So, are we talking these fairy armies? These supposedly elite forces that we just saw get taken down by a single man and a child? Or are there some other fairy armies off screen that are, you know, not trained by the Three Stooges? Commander Root herself negotiates with Artemis, but they reach an impasse. Artemis explicitly prohibits fairies from entering the house, and by magical law, they must obey. But they seize upon a loophole, since he said nothing about dwarves. So now Mulchdegums, and by extension, Josh Gad, has plot relevance now, and gets to be in the movie more. Hooray. Artemis and Holly start sniping at each other, but suddenly they bond over something unexpected.
You think it's a game.
Game? My father was kidnapped.
My father is dead.
Can I trust you? I've read in my father's journals about the Aculos. About a fairy who swore to protect it. A fairy named Beechwood.
Beechwood Short was my father.
This is such a sudden heel turn in tone towards each other. This doesn't mean anything. Nothing in this movie means anything. What am I even doing watching this? I'm just wasting my finite life on Earth watching this stupid ass piece of shit. Mulch arrives, and Root offers him time off his sentence, but Mulch just wants to be small like the rest of the dwarves. And this conversation between the two of them is great, not because the writing gets better, because it doesn't, but because of the defeated exasperation you can see in Judi Dench's face.
Either bring out Officer Short or get back to jail.
Listen to the two of us, grunting at each other like a pair of hippos with a throat infection.
Eventually, Mulch settles for time off his sentence, and gets to work digging his way into the manor. And he starts to— OH MY FUCKING GOD!
It's feeding time.
Okay, so dislocating his jaws to chew through the ground, and then rapidly pooping out the remains? Yes, that's in the book. But he's also not humanoid in the book. He's got a bit of a more cartoony description. Honestly, when I was little, I pictured Mulch Diggums looking something like this. And in the graphic novel adaptation, he seems to be a funky little creature. If this thing unhinged its jaw and started eating dirt, I'd be like, yeah, you go, little buddy. You do your thing. I don't know, maybe they didn't want to spare the budget for another creature's special effects. Maybe Josh Gad didn't want to be a small little creature. Hence the fact that he's a Josh Gad-sized dwarf instead of a dwarf-sized dwarf. I don't know. Man, I don't know. Why is this happening? Mulch gets inside and uncovers a safe, presumably where he thinks Holly Short is being kept. Upon hearing from Butler that the dwarf is inside, Artemis replies, "Let him open it! That's exactly what I want!" Again, we can't have any tension from being unsure if this undermines Artemis's plan. In fact, so far his plan has only gone the way he wanted. It's wonderful when characters never feel even slightly threatened. Artemis unlocks Holly Short, and at the same time, Mulch unlocks the vault and reveals that inside is the Aculos. Upon hearing that the Aculos is found, Opal orders her spy Cudgeon to seize control from Root.
With the Aculos in play, the game has changed. Time for a little direct action, don't you think? Let me show you how it's done.
He orders all magic to be jammed inside the house, which doesn't seem to affect Holly's weapons or her ability to fly, so I don't know why they did that. He also authorizes the deployment of the troll that Holly subdued, and they unleash it on the house. Which is a great idea. It's not like there's a delicate and important artifact at play that could be smashed to pieces by a rampaging troll. A fight happens, yada yada yada, until the troll falls and is defeated. However, it falls directly on Butler, who is badly injured and begins to die.
Help him! I can't, they've blocked my magic. Artemis, there's nothing I can do for him.
Oh, so that's why they disabled Holly's magic. so that we could have this touching scene where they cry over their dying friend. Even Holly joins in the mourning. You know, Holly, who's known him for a matter of hours and was kidnapped by him.
May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face.
Well, yeah, you know, that's, you got me, movie. He's really dying. No, yeah, it's really, really sad. I'm just heartbroken. I mean, it's not like the good cops will win out over Cudgeon and restore Holly's magic just in time to save his life.
Squad! Unblock magic!
Look out!
Wow, what an amazing twist. Hooray! Left Recon is forced to retreat when the time freeze finally breaks down. Holly Short stays behind though, and again, this is so funny. Everyone else is just getting violently ripped out of the time bubble, and then she just walks in. I guess she's got main character powers. Anyways, she agrees to use the all-powerful MacGuffin to bring back Artemis's father, who is about to be executed by Opal. And again, with the post-production clip stretching. This movie cost $125 million and this is what the climax looks like? Anyways, the Aculus works. It just works. Artemis Sr.'s home now. The movie's over. It's done. There's no showdown with the villain. I guess the mastermind Opal didn't have a plan B. So Holly is promoted to full officer because the story has to have a happy ending. Apparently, disobeying orders and treason against your species is rewarded in the fairy world. We also get this moment.
Boy, just who do you think you are?
I'm Artemis Fowl. And I'm a criminal mastermind.
No! You're not a criminal mastermind! You can't just say that at the end of the movie and expect us to ignore the previous 80-something minutes where you weren't a criminal mastermind. And then the film concludes with Mulch finishing his interrogation and this fantastic fourth wall break.
Designed by the kid. Clap your hands if you believe in fairies.
Oh, it must have been fun in the theaters to have everyone start clapping at that moment and— oh. Yeah. You know, this movie's just really, really bad. But at the same time, I don't think it was doomed to fail. In the deleted scenes, in the teaser, I believe we can see the echoes of a better adaptation of the book. Really though, in the end, the greatest sin this movie commits is that it drains the source material of its personality. Like I said before, an adaptation doesn't have to be fully faithful to be good. But to go back to the comparison I made before, for all the changes the Lord of the Rings made, it still captured what made the books unique. Its themes about unremarkable people being capable of remarkable heroism, its powerfully compelling characters, its setting of a world and transition from one era to another, these are still found in the films and that's why I think they work. But Artemis Fowl the movie has no themes. It removes Artemis's arc towards good. It makes its setting sterile and uninteresting. Even if it didn't neutralize a book I really loved as a kid, on its own, it's just a very unspecial movie, only unique in how utterly terrible it is.
You spy or you die.